What kind of stories do you tell about other people? Do you interpret other people's behavior in light of yourself? Or do you assume people are having their own experience in a way that centers themselves? When somebody challenges the stories you're telling about them, when they go, "Wait, wait, no, no, you've got it all wrong about me," how much space do you create to change your interpretation? Hi, this is Sarah Russell. I'm your Mudwater podcast host, here with your weekly mood boost, tools for transformation, and conversations full of curiosity. In today's episode, I invite you to not believe everything you think about somebody else. Right now, I'm teaching a cooperative communication course, and we just got to the part where we start unpacking the stories that we tell about each other. Now, in models like nonviolent communication, we're taught to not tell stories about each other, but just stick to the facts. There are the observable facts, which is anything a camera would pick up. And there are our feelings, which are also facts. We feel the way we feel. From there, we can make requests about what we want and need, which are also facts. We want what we want. We need what we need. And that's where a lot of conflict resolution stops. But in the method I teach, cooperative communication, we use all of those observable facts, anything a camera would pick up, the way that we're feeling, and then we go a step further and we fess up to the stories we're telling about each other. Why is this important? And y'all, this is critically important because we're constantly making guesses about why other people do what they do. We're telling these stories because we're trying to understand something that happened between us and another person, or trying to understand somebody else's motivations. But we typically tell these stories from a self-centric perspective. You did this to me. It makes sense why we do this. If the story we tell revolves around ourselves, we have some influence over what happens. The idea that somebody else's story could be all about them and not about us makes us feel powerless, and that can feel scary or overwhelming. Here's the thing. Is my behavior about me? Yeah, I'm having my own experience and I'm putting myself at the center of the action. Is your behavior about me? Probably not. You're also having your own experience and probably putting yourself at the center of the action. And it's helpful to differentiate between stories we're telling about ourselves and stories we're actually telling about somebody else, because in doing so, we can learn to tell stories that include everybody's experience and perspective, not just our own. In order to switch from a self-centric story to an other-centric story, we need to make guesses about the other person's motivations from the perspective that they're organizing around themselves. Then we need to check our story about that person with that person. If we keep our stories to ourselves, we might not be getting the whole picture. There may be pieces we're missing, we might be guessing wrong. If we don't share our stories, the other person doesn't get a chance to respond with what's true and what's not true for them. And we tend to have negative stories about other people's motivations based on our internalized oppression. That is our shame and blame response to our feelings of powerlessness within a culture of individualism. It's how we judge ourselves. In the face of the unknown, in order to try to get some control over a situation, we create dualistic, life-draining beliefs about how we're wrong or bad. Because if something is wrong with us, if we individualize, if we can make ourselves bad or wrong, then maybe we can fix it. We can have power over our situation. If we're lazy, we can work harder. Or maybe if we're smart enough, we can finally come up with a clever solution. Or maybe if we were more attractive. Or maybe if we were nicer. Internalized oppression is all the ways we make ourselves too much or not enough. We do this in an attempt to prevent bad things from happening, to shape our lives to be as danger-free as possible, and to maintain safety and connection. It's our solution to situations that kick off our fight, flight, freeze, fawn, dissociative responses. This keeps us scanning the world for danger and focusing on the worst case scenarios and catastrophizing without considering how probable it is. But what if there's a better case scenario that's at least as likely to be true that we could be organizing around instead? How many times have you asked somebody the question or been asked the question, "Are you mad at me?" only to then make the other person mad because you asked them that question. Sure, they were feeling a little grumpy, they were a little tired, maybe it was about work or the lack of last night's sleep, maybe they read something in the news, and it didn't have much to do with you, or maybe it had a little bit to do with you. But if you had told yourself a different, less self-centric story, rather than pushing the other person away, rather than irritating them, maybe you could have had a conversation that brought you closer instead of creating that disconnection, bringing curiosity to this, right? We can do this by getting good at telling other-centric stories. So the next time you're wondering if there's something wrong with you or if you did something, be suspicious. Maybe you're externalizing your feelings, making them about things outside your control. Maybe you're powerless and then making it all about you. We don't have control over what other people want or how they behave or how they're thinking. But then when they act in ways we don't like, we make it our fault for not being hypervigilant or proactive enough. We feel powerless and project ourselves into situations. We try to make everything about us so we can fix things. But if we shift from self-centric to other-centric stories, we can create a big picture story where all of us feel seen, heard, and understood. This means getting good at putting yourself in the other person's shoes. Here are some questions you can ask to shift from self-centric to other-centric stories. Why would I do something like that? Not why would somebody do that to me, but if I were them, why would I do that? Do I have enough information about their motivations? Am I filling in too many blanks? If their behavior is about them instead of about me, why would they do that? While I wish they were organizing themselves around me, do they know what would work for me? Have I told them? Have I made it clear? And I don't mean in a mind-reading kind of way. I mean explicitly, not implicitly. Is it possible that organizing around me would limit their ability to take care of themselves? Once you have your other-centric story, you can check it with the other person as they share what's true and what's not true for them. Your story may change as you gain more information. Then any decisions you make, any requests you have around what you want and need, come from a story that holds as much truth as possible rather than all of your worst fears. We're not going to stop telling stories, but we can learn to tell better stories that have more space in them. And space creates more opportunities for informed choice. Here's a poem by fellow Skills for Change coach, Molly Fisk. True story. How the mind craves a good ruse. Any excuse to entangle you. Sleek coyote intent on mischief. Monkey chattering nonsense carefully chosen to wound, confuse. The mind is rarely your friend. It aims for opposites, argues that you're undesirable, lazy, ugly, nuts, destined to always be lonely. When in reality, take another deep breath. Like any dahlia, bright under summer sun, zinnia, foxglove, leopard lily, or China rose. Like the blue-bellied lizard warming herself on a slant of granite beside this lake, or that cloud shaping itself into mare's tails. You're incredibly easy to love. Thanks so much for listening. If you enjoyed, please rate, review, and subscribe wherever it is you listen to podcasts. Also, check out mudwtr.com. That's mudwtr.com for all of our written content. You can also send a voicemail or an email to podcast@mudwtr.com, and I'd be happy to answer anonymously, of course, any of your relationship questions on this podcast. Here's to telling more life-affirming stories.